evening, everyone. Welcome to Game 5 of the Eastern Conference Finals, along with Mark Jackson and Jeff Van Gundy, Mike Breen on hand. This series, these teams, it's all about defense. That's why they're so good. But you still have to score to win the game, and that's why a couple of guys tonight are vital for their respective teams. Let's start with the Celtics. Paul Pierce is still the man. He's been here for a long time, and yes, Garnett has been brilliant this season, but Pierce is the guy offensively who can find some answers to that great Piston defense.
Well, you talk about this Celtic team. Every time their back has been against the wall, it's been Paul Pierce that's shown up and showed out. Talk about Game 7 against the Atlanta Hawks. Pierce, 22 big points, setting the tone offensively, getting to the free throw line, and then crashing the boards. And you talk about against the Cleveland Cavaliers and LeBron James, put on a stellar performance offensively. This is Game 7 like Shoot-2 in your building. It is Paul Pierce's time.
Meanwhile, for the Detroit Pistons, the guy that Boston can't figure out how to stop offensively is Rip Hamilton. Just so consistent, Jeff, night in and night out.
And yet, somehow, he's still underrated. He's so efficient, and he has no one signature move except that he moves without the ball better than anyone in the NBA. Fundamentally, on balance, and you see how it turns into performance. His efficiency, Game 3 and Game 4, he closed out Game 4 by running catch-and-shoot plays and knocking in the shots. They need Hamilton and Phillips to play well here tonight.
Celtics say one of the keys tonight, slow down Rip Hamilton. Meanwhile, let's bring in our sideline reporter, of course, Michelle Tafoya. Hey, Michelle.
Hey, Michael. I caught up with Flip Saunders just before the game to ask him what the single biggest key is tonight for the Pistons, and he summed it up in two words. Be physical. He believes that whichever team has been more physical in this series has won. And to that end, Saunders gave his team the day off yesterday. No practice, no walkthrough, no film. They didn't even see each other until they boarded the plane in Detroit. And Saunders said it was important for body and mind, but most important was the rest to their legs, which they'll need tonight in order to be physical, Mike.
All right, Michelle. Both coaches have done that throughout this series in terms of giving the extra day off. And Jeff, as a coach, talk about giving them their legs. Letting them have that day off sometimes is more important than getting back and working on the floor at this time of the year.
Well, it's a balance. You have to try to figure out as a coach, what do you need? Physical work, mental work, or no work at all? Yesterday, Flip decided no work at all, while the Celtics came in, light practice, more mental work, probably because Doc wanted to get him back together again after a difficult loss.
We've talked so much throughout these playoffs about Boston and their home floor. At 35-6 during the regular season, Rondo's first shot won't go. 9-1 here in the playoffs, but that one loss in the postseason was in Game 2 to these Pistons. They handed them their first playoff loss. The Pistons also handed them their first regular season loss as Phillips knocks it down. That was way back in December. Celtics were 12-0 at home. So Detroit feels pretty comfortable here. Ray Allen stripped. Ball taken back. And Rondo sets it back up. Shot clock did not reset as the Pistons never had possession. Nice touch pass. And Perkins, the first bucket for the Celtics.
That's pretty basketball. Guys touching the basketball, catching it, and making plays. Garnett to Perkins, high percentage possession.
Chauncey Billups did not shoot well in Game 4, but Jeff, you believe he had a very strong game.
Well, I thought he looked better, and you saw it again on the first move of the game where he blew by Rondo for the pull-up as Prince traveled. He didn't shoot efficiently, but he played and looked much better.
Traveling violation on Prince will negate that bucket. So we're still tied at 2. And the crowd into it again. It has been a revival year here in Boston for these Celtics after such a disaster last year. Ray Allen jumper in and out. Perkins pushed off to get the board. That's his first. And we see Allen miss his first shot of the game. Ray Allen struggles.
Well, I like what Doc Rivers is doing. The first play, ISO for Rondo. Third play, curl screen for Ray Allen, trying to get both guys off offensively to set a tone. You know what Pierce and Garnett are going to bring.
Doc Rivers saying before the game, Ray Allen, he's just not playing well, but I know he's still capable, and we're just waiting for that breakout game. Phillips shot in and out, Pierce the rebound. Allen telling Michelle Tafoya before, he's not trying to put too much pressure on him. Tied up that time. He's also faced some excellent defense. Perkins and Wallace spinning underneath. Wallace got a piece of it. Here comes Billups. Pass Hamilton can't handle it. And the Pistons turn it over, which has been a rare thing in the past couple of games.
Well, Rasheed Wallace does a good job keeping his body away from Perkins and using his extraordinary length. But what disrupted that play at the start was they just came off Rondo and just doubled the ball. It's going to be very important that they find Rondo, and Rondo's aggressive.
And Rondo has to recognize that, talk about it in between plays, and then get to a spot where you can catch and score.
Garnett, they did a good job of him finally in game four. He's been dominant in his series and against the Pistons. That time he draws the foul. It's going to go against Antonio McDice. Or do they call it on Wallace? Yep, it's on Wallace.
And where Garnett caught the ball was much different than in game four. He was on the post. In game four, they had him pushed out another full step, step and a half.
And you look at it, Flip Saunders is well aware of that. He coached Kevin Garnett. So he wants his guys to be more physical against Garnett on the block. You get him in this position, when he drop step and faces you, cannot be guarded.
And they were definitely more physical in game four. And Doc Rivers just felt overall that the Pistons were much more physical throughout the entire game in game four. One of the reasons why Celtics shot a lot of free throws, that's what kept them in the game, getting to the free throw line. Defense! Defense! Billups had 7 assists and no turnovers in game four. Hamilton, Rasheed Wallace for 3, puts it in. He's been really struggling from downtown, but that gives the Pistons a 2-point lead.
That play is made by the dribble penetration of Rip Hamilton. Garnett forced the help, and Rasheed winds up with an open jump.
Turnover for Boston, their first. The Pistons have 4 wins on the road already in these playoffs, tied with the Lakers. Obviously, they've played more games than a lot of other teams, but they won in each of their series on the road. Prince lines up the shot. In and out, won't go. Prince has been struggling the last couple of games shooting the ball, but he's played much better on the road for Detroit than at home during the playoffs. Rondo to Perkins. Perkins banks it in.
I really like what Rondo is doing early, putting the ball on the floor. You're not a shooter, well, make a play. Being aggressive and made that play for Perkins.
And a foul away from the ball.
It's about body language, and right now Rondo is saying to Billups, you have to defend me. I'm not a shooter, I'm not a scorer, but I have to put you in a position where I can make plays. That time did it for Perkins.
And he's driving to score. Earlier in the series, he was driving to pass. And if you drive to score, you'll make the help come and find open people like you found Perkins.
Shot about a foot short, that last foul on Ray Allen. Here comes Rondo. You saw Rondo's numbers much better at home. Ray Allen for 3. And maybe the most welcome sight for the Celtics. It's only 1, but he is really struggling to get going.
But give credit to Rondo, pushing the ball in transition, allows Ray Allen to get to the spot and then delivers the basketball.
Ray Allen coming out with that sleeve on his left arm. I don't think I've ever seen him wear that. Ball knocked loose, picked up by Pierce. Celtics force a turnover. Pierce taking his time down the floor, and it goes. He's not the quickest player in the NBA, but when he wants to get somewhere, he gets there.
You talk about their strength and the ability to get to the sweet spot. My goodness.
A 7-0 run, and Flip Saunders has to call a quick timeout. Welcome back to Boston. Game 5. Good start for the Celtics, and a good start for Ray Allen, who knocked down his first 3-pointer. But was it a 3? Very close. Allen doesn't care whether it was a 2 or a 3, I don't think. He just happened to knock down a perimeter shot. But just goes to show you, and you guys are going to destroy me for saying this, how tough it is to officiate. Look how close that is, whether it's a 2 or a 3.
That's not close. That's a 3, first of all. Outstanding camera work by our crew and outstanding refereeing by getting it right.
I agree. I think it is close. I think when you're 1 centimeter away, that's close.
But I give the officials a lot of credit. Running in transition to be able to spot that, that's very difficult. And that is Ray Allen's signature shot, the transition three.
Someday I'll get you guys on my side out of all this.
We agreed with you.
We didn't agree. Phillips to Prince. Pierce guarding Prince. He's done a good job on him. Phillips spots up for three. Chauncey Phillips, another one.
And I don't like that play by Rondo. He overhelped. Pierce had containment of Prince going to his weak hand, which is his right hand. He came off of Phillips for no reason.
And even after the play, Paul Pierce looked at him and said, hey, I don't need help. Stay on your man.
Allen, nice pass inside. Garnett. And Garnett pass one too many. Perkins not expecting it.
Well, here, Pierce is doing a very good job. Rondo, in a gamble for the steal, leaves Phillips. And again, Phillips looks very good the last game and the start of this game.
It's inside. Looked like he had a layup, but threw it back out. I mean, Perkins is in the vicinity, but he had an open shot.
That's a wide open lay-in for Chauncey Phillips. Read it the wrong way. Found Flip Saunders, but he's in a suit and tie. You're Phillips. You got to lay that in.
Saunders used to play college ball. Yeah, University of Minnesota.
It's lucky to have a coach that had game. Guy I played for in New York.
Wow. The barbs start early.
Good help defense from Wallace. Garnett from outside. Perkins the rebound. Perkins at times has been such a factor for this team. He's had some strong games, and he's active to start.
And it's about for him staying out of foul trouble. Stay on the floor, be able to play 30 to 32 minutes, and in the offseason, continue to work on your conditioning.
Hamilton can't get it to go. McDice. Hamilton gets another chance. And Perkins another rebound. Some elbows flying there. And a whistle. Going to go against Phillips. Phillips knocks down Kevin Garnett. Picks up his first. Perkins and Rondo's those other starters we've seen when they play well, when they're active, when they're aggressive, Celtics are a tough team to beat. Now the numbers scoring-wise better on the road, but he's had some good home games. Rebounding and defense, that's what he's out there for. McDice is really battling Garnett. Rondo, Garnett, good open look.
What I love about that is Kevin Garnett being fronted by McDice on the block. Instead of fighting him, comes out and sets a screen on Paul Pierce, creating that play. Trust your teammates, and he got it back.
And a foul on Rondo trying to fight over a screen, just whacked into Rasheed Wallace.
The play is for Garnett to post up. He's being fronted, make the right play. Steps out, pick and roll, the ball swings. Trust that it's going to come back to you. A better possession, a better shot.
McDice to Phillips. Shot clock down to 7. Wallace, that's a long three. Rasheed Wallace, 2 for 2 from downtown. He went through a stretch where he hit 3 of 29 from three-point range as Garnett draws another foul. It's going to go on McDice this time, and that will be his first. Free throw shooting again in game 4 was huge for the Celtics, 32 of 39, where they really struggled from the field, had only 21 field goals the entire game. And this will be their 3rd and 4th free throw to start. Reminder, our NBA calendar, tomorrow on TNT, Western Conference Finals, game 5, Spurs and Lakers from the Staples Center. Lakers with that 3-1 lead after that wild game last night. Coverage begins at 9. Then Friday at ESPN, we'll be back at the Palace for game 6 of this series. Coverage begins at 7:30. Tip off shortly after 8:30. We'll get into that Spurs Lakers a little later. I want to get your guys' take on the controversial ending.
Just take a wild guess. You think we're going to agree or disagree?
I think I know the answer. 5.5 to play here in the first. Hamilton and Allen. So much about Allen shooting, but it's his defense that's perhaps more important tonight for the Celtics, the way Rip Hamilton's been playing. That shot won't go. And Garnett already helping the Celtics on the boards. They dominated the boards at times. Pierce. Boy, short. Prince got a piece of it. Perkins. And Perkins has come out hot. 8 points and four rebounds already in the first 7 minutes.
And you can just tell that this young man believes that he can score on the block. Not looking around. When you get the offensive board, it's your time to play one-on-one. And Perkins twice already scoring.
Only averages 6 points a game in the regular season into the playoffs. He's already surpassed that here on the first. Shot clock winding down. Excellent defense. Prince has to put it up over Garnett. He gets the bounce. That's one of those excellent defense. Sometimes it just happens.
And I like Rondo's defense on the pick and roll. He's fighting much harder not to get screened early in the game.
Rondo inside, misses the layup on a nice give and go. It's been feast or famine for Rondo. He's had some good moments. He's had some real struggles. Prince to the basket. Tough shot, won't go. Rebound taken by Garnett. Ray Allen off the dribble. I'm just waiting for him to hit a couple in a row. Every time he knocks one down, people here in Boston thinking, okay, the slump may be over. Wallace will try again. Garnett. Again, trying to force it in. Celtics were at 3 turnovers. Pistons with 4. Both teams have done a pretty good job on the series on that, but a little sloppy here in the opening period.
I think that time Garnett on the block wanted to be a passer. You have to get on the low post and think score. Until the help comes, then you make the play.
Hamilton back out. Wallace is going to try another one. That's his 4th already, and he's knocked down 3 of them. Rasheed Wallace can be lethal from downtown.
You know, people are probably watching saying, why is Rasheed shooting so many threes? Well, the guy is wide open. He's a knockdown shooter getting wide open looks. That's a good shot for Rasheed Wallace of the Pistons.
Two more wins away from the finals. You know, that's every basketball player's dream, you know, to be in the finals. And a lot of players don't get to this point in their careers, and you know, when you get to this point right now, I say you got to make the most of it.
You'll feel good about the way you played. If you play hard, you can't have an excuse. If you don't win, at least you know you lay it all on the line.
Now, McDyess plays that way every night, as does Pierce. And Pierce remembered back in 2002, last time the Celtics were in the conference finals, they lost to the Nets in 6 games that year, and he said, "Okay, we'll be back next year." But he had some rough years here in Boston since then, and a little more appreciative of being back here this time.
And it's easier for the older guys to understand that message. Younger guys think, oh, it's going to happen again. No matter who you are, when you're younger, you think it's going to happen again. Success just happens. Guys like Pierce, Garnett, Allen, the veterans of the Pistons, they embrace these situations.
As Pierce gets in, nice move. Although you can't blame Tayshaun Prince for thinking that. Every year he's been in the league, he's gone to the conference finals. I'm jealous. 3-point Celtic lead. First substitution of the game, Jason Maxiel, who was terrific in game 4. First off the bench to give McNice a little break. Shot clock at 6. Prince way short. Perkins the rebound. He got pushed by Maxiel.
But you see in that situation, Garnett playing center field almost like Billup does against Rondo when Rondo's on offense. Since Garnett has Maxiel, he helped everybody on that possession.
Celtics here at home, their defense has been unbelievable in the 10 playoff games on their home floor. Teams averaging under 82 a game, shooting 39%. As Pierce knocks it down. Paul Pierce, now 3 for 4 from the field.
Just a good read. Kevin Garnett getting ready to come over and set a screen. Paul Pierce looks and says no, wanted the ISO, and then turns, knocks down the jump over front.
Phillips gets past Rondo. Rondo trying off to the shot. Perkins another rebound. 6 boards for Perkins. He's had double figures twice in the series. Ray Allen the floater. And Rondo the rebound. Bad pass. Each team with 4 turnovers. Maxiel trying to clear some space. Tough shot over Perkins. Well, he plays with a lot of confidence. You get the feeling the only reason he doesn't play more minutes is because they've got such a good front line. Well, he's going to get his chance someday here.
Well, there's no reason for him not to play more minutes. Phillips comes up with the steal.
Back-to-back turnovers. Garnett fouls Phillips. And for Garnett, that will be his first.
And when I talk about playing more minutes, because you have the luxury of being able to play him with Wallace or McDice, so he should be on the floor a lot.
They're discussing whether or not it's a clear path foul. Kenny Maurer checking with Callahan. Let's take a look at his mind. He does foul him from behind. Clear path would be two shots and the possession. If there's no defender between the ball and the basket when the foul occurs in a play that originates in the backcourt, that's a clear path foul. And that's the way they decide. They just changed the rule a couple of years ago. It used to be one shot and possession. Now it's two shots and possession. Let's see, was Rondo ahead of him? That's the question mark. That's very close, but he did foul him from behind.
Now that's a good call. It's a heavy penalty. You're better served fouling him once he gets in the act of shooting, so then it's only two shots.
Right. A lot of that rule is to prevent guys on fast breaks, nobody ahead of him, somebody from behind committing a hard foul, which can hurt somebody. It kind of discourages you from taking a wild shot. As P.J. Brown checks in for the first time. But like you said, much heavier penalty now that they've made it two shots and possession.
And Boston's offense is hurting them right now with the turnovers. The turnover game is fueling Detroit's offense.
Phillips looking to post up Rondo. Nice move. Can't get it to fall. Perkins has been a monster on the boards.
Really can't say enough about the job that Perkins is doing offensively, but dominating the board.
He has more rebounds than the entire Piston team here in the opening quarter. As Prince reaches in, Pierce draws the foul on him, and he'll go to the line.
And that's such smart offense. When you're such a good shooter like Pierce is, Prince has his hand extended to try to contest the shot, and then Pierce brings the ball up through his arm to draw the shooting foul. Very good, very intelligent offense by Pierce.
Celtics now 3 of 5 from the line.
See, the hand is extended to try to be able to get up on that shot. You just rip it through the old Detlef Schrempf move.
I had a chance to talk to Pierce. He says, hey, I feel like I cannot be defended one-on-one. And I tell you what, he's definitely right in that analogy as far as he's concerned offensively. Has the package, and with the ball in his hands, I've watched this guy time and time again. He's unstoppable when he's on his game.
And with Rondo on the floor, he's never going against straight single coverage. It's always a man and a half, which is much more difficult.
Rodney Stuckey checks in. And a defensive 3 seconds called against the Celtics. So a technical foul, one free throw. Phillips will go to the line.
Now you think about it, Mike. Two free throws given away on the clear path. Now you have a defensive 3. These are the things that can come back in a close game to haunt you.
It's like giving away points.
Well, you make a great point. Everybody will pay attention to the final play down the stretch, but really don't realize that these crucial points that you're giving away in the first quarter, that's the reason why you lose ball games.
That's why you always hear veterans and coaches talk about playoff games every possession, how important it is right from the start. Stuckey creates some space and knocks it down.
Rondo's getting caught on the side of people defensively. He's got to square him up. And particularly Stuckey, who's not really a range shooter, make him shoot it up over the top from range.
Well, he's a gambler by nature. You got to stay in front of guy.
About a 4 second difference between shot clock and game clock. Stuckey is guarding Pierce. Now Prince comes to help. Prince tells him, I'm okay. Rondo fires a 3. Rebound, P.J. Brown. Plenty of time. Posey for 3. That won't go. Blocked by Prince. Doc Rivers hopping up and down. He wanted a goaltend. A great rejection from Tayshaun Prince, known for his playoff blocks, but Doc Rivers didn't think it was legal.
Flip Saunders, you told me before the game you wanted your team to be physical. How do you think they've responded?
I think we've been good. We turned it over a little bit early, first few times down the floor, but we eased our way into it, settled down a little bit. We shot the three really well. I think we're in pretty good rhythm right now.
You often say you finish how you start, and strangely, this game hasn't had a quick start by either team. So what would you like to see different?
I think one, if we can keep our turnovers down. We made a couple where we dribble a little bit too much, keep the ball moving, get our assist to turnover ratio up a little bit.
Flip, thank you.
Thanks, officer.
Mike?
All right, Michelle. And if that guy can keep hitting threes, first four games of the series, he hit 2 3-pointers, 2 for 11. In the first quarter, he already has three of them, and that can be such a weapon for a team that's been struggling from downtown in this series. Stuckey against Pierce. Perkins hauls down another rebound, already with 9. Sam Cassell getting the early minutes as the backup point. Cassell has struggled on the road, but has played some good minutes here at home.
And you can see right away, Flip Saunders is sending in Lindsey Hunter. The ball pressure so crucial. Want to make life miserable for Sam.
B.J. Brown, double. This is playing a very physical defense. Doc Rivers and some of the Celtics were talking about what some people call the Riley rule the other day, saying that if you foul every time, the officials are going to stop calling half of them. You just keep fouling and fouling and fouling, and then they'll only pick out the more severe ones. That always comes from usually the team that lost the previous game.
Yeah, I never heard Coach Riley say that.
Well, meaning his teams used to do that. Play that tough defense where they fouled you so much, you just played so physical, it was hard to just pick a hard foul. Perkins again. How about Perkins? 10 points, 9 boards.
I love what Perkins is doing, but I disagree with Doc. We defended in New York without fouling. We were finesse.
Doc Rivers was part of the Riley teams in New York, those great defensive teams, as Hamilton knocks down the shot.
That's good ball advancement by Sam Cassell, getting the ball ahead, eliminating the pressure of Hunter.
Hamilton on Pierce. Pierce takes his time. Shot won't go. P.J. Brown tips it out. Sam Cassell. Perkins lost it, picked up by Hamilton. He wanted a foul, as did the crowd. Stuckey alley-oop, and a foul on Brown. That's a tough, hard foul. Maxiel was up in the air as Brown knocked him to the ground. Now let's see, they're going to discuss whether or not it's a flagrant foul.
That's not a flagrant foul. P.J. Brown trying to eliminate the dunk attempt. That's good basketball, good playoff basketball. It's a foul, but it's not a flagrant.
With a guy up in the air, though, Mark, that's where a guy gets hurt.
Why don't you just shake his hand and ask him to sign his shoes for you? This is playoff basketball. That's a good play by P.J. Brown.
I concur. That's not a flagrant foul. Flagrant fouls are not how the guy falls. It's what has actually happened. There was no windup. There was no follow-through.
And they're going to call a flagrant one on it. Doc Rivers obviously feels the way you guys do. So it's going to be two shots and the ball.
See, this has got to be different than in the regular season. This can't be called the same way. Too much is on the line. You can't be giving guys points. If you want to keep control of the game in the regular season and you make a call like that and you make a mistake, it's not a big deal. But in the playoffs, if you miss one of these calls, it can come down. Now they've got a breakaway, which was correctly called, a defensive three, and now a flagrant.
I still think when a guy goes up in the air, let's watch Doc Rivers.
Well, what are you supposed to do?
No, just let me finish. Doc Rivers, he goes up in the air. Rivers obviously upset as soon as he found out flagrant one. And you push with the body. If you're going up to try and block the shot, that's one thing. If you got your hands on the body and push the guy with his body when he's up in the air, then I think you have a different story.
He didn't push him with his hands on the lower body. He didn't jump as high. His hands were extended up.
You're better than that, Mike Green.
I want a segment sponsored by a sponsor where Mark can go into this thing. Are you kidding me? And this would be the first installment. Are you kidding me, Mike Green? Where did he push him?
That's a
in the armpit?
Yeah, he's pushing him in the armpit.
He's eliminating the dunk attempt, forcing him to go to the line.
All right. I just think when the guy's up in the air, that's the danger situation. That's where guys get hurt.
Well, here's what you look at, the way that Maxiel got up. He's not frustrated. That's a basketball play. Go to the line and shoot you too.
You're talking about one of the tough guys in the NBA. He's not going to care. He likes the contact.
I've seen CYO games with more contact than that play.
That's a flagrant in the CYO, that's for sure.
You know, see, I'll tell you, do they even have flagrant fouls in CYO? No. Of course not. Appleton will go to the line as Posey picks up his first.
And see, tomorrow when it's rescinded, what good does that do the Boston Celtics?
Well, let's see if it's rescinded. Hamilton knocks down the first.
I believe it will be because this guy next to me has influence.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, boy. I always thought that after I was getting fined.
We want a lot of free throws here for the Pistons. And they're up by three, their largest lead in the first half. Hunter with another steal. Alley-oop. Axel on the finish. Lindsey Hunter, it seems every time he comes in the game, he steals the ball right away.
So you have to have somebody else bring it up, though.
Hunter putting on great ball pressure. Garnett. Travel. Shuffle his pivot foot. And that's now 8 turnovers for Boston.
You see the ball pressure of Lindsey Hunter. Good strip and then recognition upstairs to McDice on Maxiel, the big time finish, and it forces Doc Rivers to bring Rondo back in the game to eliminate the pressure of Lindsey Hunter.
You see, the bottom line is their guard play has just not been good enough. From Ray Allen to Rondo to Cassell, it's just not been good enough. Who do you play?
Another alley-oop and another foul on P.J. Brown. He's a little frustrated as Maxiel has made his presence felt from the moment he stepped on the floor. Eddie F. Rush tells Doc Rivers, go back to your bench.
Well, again, this is a good roll by Maxiel. Good play.
Crowd looked at the replay, they didn't like it. Maxiel had that big game 4, 6 for 6 from the field.
So I have a question for you. If he would have fallen down, was that flagrant?
No.
That's the same exact play that P.J. Brown just made on the break.
I don't think it's the same play.
Stopping Maxiel from getting the basket at the rim.
Mark, one thing I always respect about you, when you're wrong, you just come out and say you're wrong. Unfortunately, the man to my left just can't muster that up.
He's like Fonzie. You remember when Fonzie said, I'm wrong. He couldn't get out. I was wrong. Just say I'm wrong.
That's a good point. And for you kids out there, that's a happy day.
Good 25. Detroit by 6, 2.5 down by here in the second. Pistons defense picking it up again. Excellent double teaming and a foul and a sarcastic cheer from the crowd.
But this was very important that the Celtics remain poised. You cannot just continue to foul. Adjust to the way the game is being called. Here, the Pistons do a great job. Maxiel, good solid trap. I don't see a foul there. I don't see a foul there. That's a good defensive sequence by Detroit. A great rotation by Lindsey Hunter.
And Maxiel with 3 fouls will sit down. He's been a real spark coming off the bench. And a little stretch here. He wasn't playing a lot. Last several games, though, a huge impact. Shot clock down to 5. Rondo, nice feed, Brown. They're going to wave it off. A 3-second violation as P.J. Brown was camped out. And that's the 9th turnover for Boston. And we haven't even played 15 minutes yet.
But you see what Flip Saunders is doing. He's saying, hey, Lindsey Hunter, you don't have to defend Rondo. I want you to roam and create havoc. Doing exactly that. You're Rondo, you have to get to a spot, catch, and make a play quick. You can't allow Lindsey Hunter to dictate the game on your offensive end.
Hunter doesn't play a lot of minutes, but he plays so well in a limited time out there. Garnett for deflection. Theo Ratliff has come in for Maxiel. Feed inside, McDice. And it's now an 8-point lead for the Pistons on 10 straight now.
Think about how tough a job it is for Lindsey Hunter. He said, I'm not going to play you all year long, but when it matters most, I'm going to put you in to do what you do best. He's ready and has had an impact.
Rondo, and they finally get off the stride and end the run.
And again, he has to find an open spot, like Mark said. Lindsey Hunter live off of Rondo, went to double Pierce. Pierce, good play. Rondo, good layup.
Hamilton, Ratliff. Hamilton inside. Good Celtic defense. This time, Rondo with the steal. Here comes Boston, 4-on-2. Pierce ahead of the pack, back to Garnett for the slam. And that awakens Garnett and the crowd. Flip Saunders wants a timeout to settle it down. Stuckey and Hunter in the backcourt with Ratliff, McDice, and Hamilton. Stuckey, and he's fouled. So a three-guard offense right now for Detroit.
And Brewski doesn't just hit hard. He holds the ball for Lucky, the mascot. Oh, that's great elevation by the Luckster.
Brewski got a huge ovation. Hear me out onto the floor. Stuckey will now go to the line for two. Stuckey, of course, has played some great minutes with Billups out with the injury.
And he has got great strength. Right there, he drove past Rondo. He got his shoulder by him and knocked him back. Again, Mark, you've talked about it. Rondo's got to keep that ball in front of him. Particularly, Stuckey's not a range shooter.
One of two from the line. Really can't talk enough about the impact that this Pistons bench has. Flip Saunders went to his bench and those guys changed the game. Blocking foul on Hunter. Hunter picks up his first, and the Pistons with their third team foul. Hunter, I just, you know, we said it last game. He's amazing with his age, the type of shape he's in, and still such a premier on the ball defender.
He has a defined role and he plays to that role. He knows who he is. And he does a great job playing his role and accepting his role.
Pierce. And there's Hunter on his help defense. Ray Allen's going to check back in.
You look in that situation. Lindsey Hunter is the guy defending Rondo. As soon as the ball is released, he's ignoring him, getting ready to be in help position for Rip Hamilton against Pierce. He's not even paying attention to Rondo. Here's where Rondo has to look to make a play. Either pass and cut through, or put the ball on the floor and make a play.
Garnett has to put it up. Shot clock expiring, and he knocks it down.
And if I'm Flip Saunders, I mean, if I'm Doc Rivers, I'm thinking about playing Ray Allen, Posey, and Pierce together to keep everybody honest on the floor.
Ratliff on the follow. Off the penetration, Ratliff left open, and it's back to five for Detroit.
That's a big-time play by Ratliff, but the smalls for the Celtics have to keep a body on the big bodies of the Pistons.
And a foul away from the ball, Ratliff upset. Ratliff arguing with Mike Callahan. So he picks up his first. Pistons with their 14th foul. Ratliff getting limited duty. His second stint with the Pistons, former draft pick with Detroit. Led the NBA in block shots for a number of years. Injuries have hurt him over the past several years.
I think right now, if you're the Celtics, realize that now the Pistons are in the penalty. So you have to be aggressive with the basketball and use their aggressiveness and intensity against them. Look to get to the line.
Garnett. Step. Bank shot won't go. P.J. Brown kept it alive, and Garnett comes right back. Intangible play from P.J. Brown.
And Stuckey, who's not yet have enough experience to be a great help defender, followed Rondo to the weak side, which gave Garnett more room to maneuver on his initial post move.
Prince inside. And Pistons getting some good looks. Station on Prince with his second field goal. Lost the ball, was going to hand it off to Rondo, knocked out of bounds. And another sloppy play from the Celtics. That's their 10th turnover. Allen looking at Rondo, but that wasn't a smart play with a defender right on him.
Not taking care of the basketball, very careless and lethargic on the offensive end. That's inexcusable, but give credit to the Pistons defense. They're not just taking punches, they are delivering punches and creating havoc.
They were swarming in game four, doing a lot more of that here in game five again. Prince wants the ball. We're going to post up Pierce. Backs in. Good help from Rondo to strip it. Ball gets to McDice. Back out Stuckey. Two on the shot clock. And Perkins the rebound. Already in double figures. Allen to the basket. Celtics haven't had a lot of easy looks. They need more of those.
And that was a great outlet pass by Perkins and a good kick ahead by Rondo.
Still Pistons ball. And Stuckey knocked to the ground.
Tremendous half-court defense by both teams.
Phillips bumped out of bounds. Still Piston ball, 16 on the shot clock. Inside, and Hamilton puts it in. Somebody lost his man on that inbound pass. Ray Allen with a perplexed look.
Detroit does a great job executing baseline and out of bounds. We saw the curl in game two that got him a layup late. Same similar set, different ending.
Here's his foul before the block shot. And he'll go back to the line.
Well, they bring Chauncey Billups off to the corner. Pierce protecting the corner. Ray Allen gets screened in a delayed screen, the screener type of action. So Pierce's job in Boston's scheme is to take away the corner. But then Kevin Garnett's got to protect the basket for a count. But he's so worried about Rasheed Wallace's three that he hugs his man and opens up the layup.
Well, the problem is when the Celtics are locked in defensively, they are able to do both of those things because they're lackadaisical on the defensive end, no commitment, and you give up easy lane for Hamilton.
Pierce's numbers is that foul on Wallace, his second personal. Only player in foul trouble here in the first half, Max Seal, who picked up three quick ones as Pierce misses the free throw. Celtics, both teams have been shooting so well from the line, but the Celtics just 5 of 8. Hamilton, quick shot. A lot of room there to shoot.
Well, in the first quarter, they were defending that by playing on top of Ray Allen, Richard Hamilton, and they defended it well. That time, Ray Allen, a missed scheme assignment and got screened.
And another foul off the ball. McDice called for his second personal. The Pistons in the penalty.
Ray Allen in the first quarter is playing on top of Hamilton, so he couldn't come up clean to that free throw line area.
And what he was looking to do is cheat the screen. He was looking to go in between the screeners. You got to keep a body on Rip Hamilton and look to fight through.
And there's Garnett, good early numbers. Garnett throughout these playoffs, he's led this team in scoring 10 times. He's led them in rebounding 14 times. He's even led them in assists 3 times. Of course, he leads them in defense night after night. Knows the overall postseason numbers. Finally back into getting some playoff games. His teams in Minnesota missed the playoffs the last 3 years. He was so emotional before game one of the opening round against Atlanta.
Well, and when we start putting numbers up, we should start putting defensive numbers up. Blown by 5 times. Missed help 4 times. Because the Celtics right now, whatever their individual offensive numbers are, their defensive numbers aren't even close.
Un-Celtic like. Hamilton misses. Wallace tips it out. Prince able to get it.
I think anytime the Pistons want to get the ball in the hands of Rip Hamilton, they will get a wide open look the way he uses screen.
Prince. Down to Wallace. Perkins guarding in. Wallace sees the shot clock down the other end of the floor. Takes his time, that high release. And Kevin Garnett grabs another rebound, his fifth. Allen to Rondo. Rondo, Garnett. Sidesteps inside to Perkins. Perkins shot partially blocked. Wallace got a piece of it. Ball still loose. Rondo puts it up, rushed it. And it's knocked out of bounds. Still Boston ball.
But Rondo was wide open initially to shoot it, threw it to Garnett. Garnett was wide open. To me, you've got to take the open shot.
And you like the unselfish play, but
sometimes the most unselfish play is taking the open shot.
A under 4 minutes of play here in the first half. Pierce for three. That's good. Paul Pierce now with 12 points, and the Celtics back within one.
You know, sometimes as a point guard, you have to read the play. And if I'm Rondo, I'm reading Paul Pierce's body language right now and getting him involved offensively.
Garnett guarding Billups. Rondo right now is on Rasheed Wallace. Billups from way downtown. And Rondo the rebound. Allen for three. Bang! Celtics back in front.
Great job by Rondo searching out Ray Allen in transition, and a great adjustment by the Celtics to switch to Billups, Rasheed Wallace, high pick and roll.
Celtics on an 8-0 run, and that's that transition three by Allen that you talked about. Ball was deflected, so it's still Pistons ball. He gets a lot of his points that way, Jeff, but it hasn't been there in the last couple of rounds. Allen in game two had that 25-point game, and they thought, okay, he's out of his slump. But then the next two got 7 of 24, including 1 of 9 from three-point range. However, much more, at least looks much more comfortable in this game, Mark.
So doing a great job of running ahead of the pack and Rondo advancing the basketball. So he's putting himself in a position to catch and shoot.
Billups with 4 on the shot clock. Can't get it to go, and Perkins now with 11 rebounds. He's got a double-double here in the first half.
The thing that has kept the Celtics in this ball game and allowed them to get the lead, 25-9 advantage on the board. Rebounding, rebounding, rebounding.
Here's to the basket. Prince stripped by Rondo. Puts it off, bank shot, won't go. Perkins on the tip. Kendrick Perkins having an incredible first half. 10 straight points now for Boston.
He keeps playing like this, he's gonna earn a nickname. We gotta get him a nickname. PK or KP.
Let's think about it before we throw him out there. Hamilton. Stolen by Pierce. Pierce to the basket. Blocked from behind by McDice, and then a foul. So Pierce will shoot two. He's slow to get up. They're able to block the shot clean, but after the release, Pierce still up in the air, and that's where the contact was. He's apparently okay. With a smile.
Hand in the passing lane, comes up with the steal, and then puts his head down. Good job of trying to finish McDice, the block shot, but contact on the body, forcing Pierce down.
You rarely see that called in the NBA, where they get it clean up top, and after the play is finished, where the player who shot it has landed, then calling the foul. I think that is a missed call right there.
Well, Pierce, meanwhile, who started it with a defensive play. We're talking to him before the game, and both you guys have been raving about his defense throughout these playoffs, so we asked him about it, and his comment was, hey, I feel I've been a top 10 defender throughout my career. He says, my offense overshadows my defense, and quite frankly, we've played on some bad defensive teams. He thinks he's always been a very good defender.
Come back to me, Paul. No, he probably been better than we probably haven't noticed. When you're on a bad team, no one notices anything. It's the hardest thing to convince a player on a bad team. If you score a lot, no one cares, no one notices. Play on a winning team, and everybody notices every good thing about you.
I will give him credit this. He could be the best defender in the postseason so far.
Wow. Ray Allen, meanwhile, arguing on that call. Allen trying to fight through the screens. He feels there. Come on, let's let that go. He's trying to plead his case to Mike Callahan.
But what you can't do if you're Ray Allen in that situation is allow Rip Hamilton to go both ways. Your job is to sit on one shoulder and force him one way, trusting the help on the opposite side.
Oh, I love that. How many times was that told to you, my good man to my right? Give him one way to go. You can't let him dictate.
I was taking notes.
Why didn't you ever put it into practice then?
It didn't matter that I was preparing for this moment.
Oh, okay.
Allen, one of two. Perkins with his 13th rebound of the first half, and we still have a minute and a half remaining. Here's Garnett. Rondo, two on the shot clock. Garnett's going to have to force it up. Just gets it off. Banks it in! Garnett from downtown as the shot clock expires.
But once again, hate the hop on it. Rondo has to shoot that basketball. Garnett bailed him out, but Rondo has to be aggressive.
A minute remaining in the first half. Wallace has already hit three threes. Make it four. Rasheed Wallace comes back with a big shot.
The problem is, with all that action inside, Kendrick Perkins switched and got on Wallace, and then they ran into a high pick and roll, and he had a hard time closing out.
Rondo closes that one out. And the Celtics back up by six. Hamilton throws it to Prince. Actually, between Prince and Billups, Prince the one to get it. Hamilton off the dribble to the basket. Block! Perkins with the rejection. Hamilton and Perkins yapping at each other coming up the floor. The officials don't see it. Pierce's shot won't go. And Billups the rebound. They were behind everybody, including the refs. Otherwise, you may have seen the double technical. Don't forget, coming up the Toyota halftime show, Stuart Scott, John Barry, Michael Wilbon analyze the first half, and the story behind Rip's mask become superstition. Shot clock down to three. Hamilton doesn't realize it, not going to get it off in time, and a 24-second violation.
That was a poor play by Billups. He had a switch with Kendrick Perkins on him. He's got to take it and create a shot.
Celtics will have 1.9. And Doc Rivers will use his 22nd timeout. Now they put a couple of tenths of a second back up. It's 2.2.
They just called a delay of game on Garnett for having a shirt tail out.
Posey fires it to Garnett. Three-pointer at the buzzer. And it comes up short. But a strong finish here in the second quarter for the Boston Celtics. They trail by as many as eight in the second period. But a 14-point turnaround that ends with a 16-4 run. Perkins just magnificent in the opening half, and he's with Michelle.
Thank you, Mike. 13 rebounds, more than the entire Pistons roster combined. How have you been so effective on the glass?
Well, I'm just being active. You know, doubling and helping off of Rondo and myself, so I'm just finding an open gap and getting rebounds.
Talk about the block shot just here toward the end that set off the fast break.
We talked about it in the film that I got to be alert on the weak side. And so I just came out just trying to be physical tonight.
Thank you, Kendrick.
All right.
Wallace coming alive from downtown for Flip Saunders. Let's check in with Michelle.
Yeah, Mike, I just spoke with Flip Saunders, and he did mention the fact that they haven't allowed Boston's bench to score at all. But for him, it came down to one word. And you guys have mentioned it, rebounding. He said, that's all you need to know. We're doing everything else great, but we're getting beat so badly on the boards that we're giving them too many opportunities. And eventually, that's going to wear us down.
That certainly offset the early turnover problems that the Celtics were having.
Pat Riley used to always tell our teams, no rebounds, no rings.
Turnover for Billups. And for the Pistons, that's number 9. Pierce, and a foul away from the ball. This one's going to go, I believe, against Wallace. Nope, my mistake. It's Hamilton is first. There, I said it. I said I was wrong.
That's a shock. You see, neither one of us responded. We're still in shock.
But it was a good call by the ref. Rondo looking inside, finding Perkins. Perkins again. 14 points on 7 of 10 from the field.
I mean, this guy's playing unbelievable. Absolutely unbelievable, the performance that Perkins is putting on.
And this is the largest lead for the Boston Celtics. Pistons had an 8-point lead at one point. Hamilton inside, McDice. Boy, they're just banging each other around, and an offensive foul call. The physical play continues as Hamilton quickly picks up his second. Let's take a look. After the pass, Pierce standing in there drawing the charge.
Once again, Paul Pierce coming over in help position, taking a hit from Rip Hamilton. That's outstanding help defense.
Pierce's defense, again, has been a topic throughout these playoffs. Nice pass to Pierce, and he puts it in. Beautiful feed from Garnett. Timeout as we have our first double-digit lead of the night. Point lead for the Celtics. This one's been a roller coaster ride. Last game, four Pistons led wire to wire. Teams exchanging lead as we have a whistle and a defensive 3 seconds against Boston. So a one shot technical. So Hamilton will go to the line. And the Pistons won game two here to even the series. Celtics came back and won. Celtics have won every single game, what you call swing games. They've never trailed in a series, so they've always won games one. Of course, in this one, after it was tied at one apiece, they won game three. They've won all the big game fives. They've won their two game sevens. As Wallace's shot won't go. And right now with a 9-point lead.
When the Celtics get a rebound, Mike, don't even announce who gets it unless it's somebody other than Perkins, because he's getting every rebound right now.
Garnett. Perkins, another rebound. That's 15. And the shot. Kendrick Perkins having one of the nights of his career. 11-point lead. 16 points, 15 boards. Both playoff highs. The young man from Beaumont, Texas. Prince able to hit. And Prince comes back. By the way, if you're wondering what the NBA playoff record is for most rebounds in a game, Wilt Chamberlain had 41 as Garnett knocks down the shot. Guy named Bill Russell had 43 times, so Perkins has the ways to go, but what a performance he's putting on.
I'm gonna go out on a limb and say that Perkins won't break the record. It's just a hunch.
Hamilton. Phillips gets himself some room. Can't hit the three. I'd like to say Pierce got the rebound, but I'm not allowed.
No, you can't. But when Perkins gets it, you don't have to say it. Because it's just assumed okay. That he's getting every rebound.
I got you. Four fouls on McDice.
Well, hey, you get offensive rebounds, you earn the right to go one-on-one. Perkins diversifying his game, going with the fadeaway, and then taking the long jog up the sideline. It's like a home run try.
And this is where, you know, afterwards, reported that you had the whole package going, even offensively. The person said, hey, it's nothing new. I know I can do this all season long. I've been waiting for my number to be called.
He's only 23 years old. You know, one of those players right from high school to the NBA. He's never put up big numbers. Just a solid rebounder and defender. But having a great night so far. Wallace pokes it out of bounds. Shot clock is down to 7. Came from a very successful high school program. Owens in high school in Beaumont. His teams were 96-3 when he was at high school. Got used to winning. Came to Boston. And unfortunately for him, started to get used to losing until this season. Garnett going against Ratliff with Dice on the bench with the 4 fouls. Garnett puts it in, and the lead is ballooned to 13. It always seems when an unlikely person steps up and has a huge game, the crowd gets into it a little bit more, and this crowd is fired up with the player Perkins. Wallace, quick shot, hits another 3. That's his 5th three-pointer of the game.
That was well defended. Rondo did a good job veering back into a switch. He just, Wallace just shot over the smaller Rondo.
Pierce looking for Garnett, who's doubled. Perkins is open. Kicks it out to Rondo. Rondo up for the layup. Blocked by Ratliff. Perkins passed open, open shot that time.
Well, made the right play to Rondo, but Rondo has to be ready to catch and shoot. He really took it back into the trees.
Phillips with the jump shot. And 5 quick points for the Pistons.
And Perkins is not used to playing this many minutes. He stayed out of foul trouble. He's played more minutes. This is usually the number of minutes he plays in a game. About 25, 26, he's already played that. Be interesting to see if he has the energy to continue.
Ray Allen answers with another three. His second one of the game. Play made by Rondo. Dribble penetration, forcing himself to be defended, and then finds Ray Allen. Ratliff lost it, but a foul. And Garnett says it was me. That's his second.
This is off of Rondo being aggressive. Looks to get a paint touch. Ray Allen does a good job of rolling to the open spot. And then Rip Hamilton, too late, can't be there to contest. Allen, another dagger.
So Ratliff, who's going to get these minutes now because of the foul trouble to McDice. Allen gets the bucket because Rondo, as a brick, has 10 assists. Now, Rondo's been a subject of a lot of debate. He's had some real struggle games. He's had some pretty good moments as well. You know, we talk a lot about what he doesn't do, but when he's aggressive, some good things happen for this team.
Well, hey, you can't argue. He's 10 assists is a lot of assists. He's done a good job. He just has to continue to work on his game so that he feels confident in shooting the ball when they double off of him.
He's like one of those players where one game you'll watch him and you'll say, he might be a little underrated. Next game you watch him and say, oh, he's overrated.
The doctor has talked about the thing he loves about this young man. He's a good listener. He will come after a bad game or a good game, listen to doctor with a guy that has had experience of playing the point guard position, and try to instill those things into his own game.
That foul on Rip Hamilton, who's third. Three team fouls. And Ray Allen hits a three. Back-to-back three-pointers for Ray Allen. He's got 14. And the lead is 14.
If you're Rip Hamilton, you have to talk to Rasheed Wallace. You have to be on top of that screen. You can't allow Ray to get a wide open look off the pick and roll.
Prince a wide open look. Now Garnett comes to contest it, and Prince can't hit it. Allen the rebound. Here come the Celtics. Allen wanted it. He was open for three, and Pierce didn't see him. Perkins feeling his oats, and he's called for a travel. Boy, he is jacked up tonight.
Well, this was a good swing of the ball by Rondo. Very good screen by Perkins. And as Mark said, Wallace has to get up to prevent that three-point shot and make Allen drive the ball.
Celtics from downtown, 6 for 8. And both teams were struggling from three-point range until tonight. Phillips gets inside. Nice maneuver. And Chauncey Phillips with 12.
Again, another gamble by Rondo, trying for the steal, which led to an easy basket. And the Celtics' defensive intensity has dropped in the last 3 to 4 possessions.
Rondo trying to find some room. Dangerous pass, and Garnett foul on the entry pass. That's going to be Wallace's fourth. Make that his third foul. It is on Wallace. 14 foul. So 3 on Wallace, 3 on Hamilton, 3 on Maxio, and McDice has 4. McDice, who's been perhaps their most consistent player, gonna have to sit for a while. Crowd chanting Wallace, Wallace. He's one of those players so beloved in his hometown. The fans love him in Detroit, but one of the villains on the road. Rondo, Garnett. Allen looking for an opening. Back to Garnett. Kevin Garnett puts it in. Great look from Ray Allen.
What they're doing right now is an outstanding job of making plays for each other. Man movement, ball movement, dribble penetration, and finding the open man.
Celtics 8 of 10 from the field in this third quarter. Incredible shooting against this strong Piston defense. Garnett all over Prince. A little over aggressive, and that's his third. And for the Celtics, it's only their second team foul. We'll have timeout. Flip Saunders out, way out on the floor, having something to say to both Mike Callahan and Kenny Maurer. Phillips as well. They've got to be careful. He wants a defensive 3 seconds. So Maurer calmly talking to him. Saunders will talk to his team. Celtics by 14 here, just past the midway point of the third. Pierce remembers back in 2002 how disappointed he was not making the NBA Finals. He's got a chance. They're 2 wins away. And right now, one of those games, they're up by 14. Maxeal back in the game. Prince looking for Maxeal. He has been a real spark. They're going to post up Perkins, up and under, blocked by Perkins, and a 24-second violation. Perkins just keeps making plays.
I think the most exciting person, in the world right now should be Perkins H. The way that this guy is playing on both ends of the floor says the Maxeal, not on my watch. Big-time effort and energy from Perkins.
That's his second block of the game. To go along with those 16 points and 16 rebounds.
And Detroit's gone into 1-2-2 half-court trap.
And a defensive 3 seconds call on Theo Ratliff. So a technical foul. And you have to be within guarding distance of your man, arm's length, if you're going to play defense in the post for more than 3 seconds. Your man moves out, you've got to get out too. And Allen. He's almost a gimme at the free throw line, although he did miss 2 in game 4. Knocks that one down. The lead is up to 15.
One thing I would begin to look at if I'm Doc Rivers, I'd stay on top of Rondo as far as, are you fine? There's no need to take this young guy out of the ball game and allow the momentum to be turned by Lindsey Hunter on the bench of Detroit. First,
Allen misses. Maxeal back to Prince. Under 5 minutes remaining here in the third. Ball deflected by Perkins. Who else? Garnett. Pierce for three. And Maxeal the rebound.
Those last two possessions where we've got a big lead type of possession. And that type of thinking can get you in trouble.
Hamilton. The double team forcing a turnover. That's the 13th for Detroit. Allen to Pierce. Here's Sorondo, back to Garnett. Garnett's jumper, knocks it down. 17-point game.
You know, you touched on something, talking about those rush plays. But if I'm Doc Rivers, I don't mind it as much because you still have your foot on the gas pedal. They are staying aggressive offensively.
Maxeal, the jump shot. Can't get it to go. And here's Rondo. Rondo going to the basket, up and under, blocked. Ratliff throws it back. Starts the fast break for the Pistons, and Pierce mauls Billups. Wraps his arms around him. Billups goes down. They're not in the penalty. I don't think they call it the act of shooting yet. Pierce making sure he's okay. Good sportsmanship from Pierce.
Not to belabor a point, but if this is not a flagrant, and the foul in the first half is, then I just don't understand what it's all about.
I couldn't agree with you more. I think that's similar to the play that Marvin Williams made in the Atlanta series. The correct play, even though Pauls wasn't trying to hurt Phillips, this is a play.
It's certainly not a basketball play. I agree with you guys. This was from the first half on P.J. Brown.
I mean, there's a tackle on the second play.
Yep.
There's an armpit touch on the first play.
And again,
I don't think that was a flagrant either. I mean, I think the referees made the right call. I don't think that's a flagrant foul. But I'm just saying, I don't understand the inconsistency in calling these plays. To me, it takes something blatant in the playoffs to be a flagrant foul.
Well, sometimes a lot, and you guys touched about this in the first half, sometimes a lot has to do with the way a guy lands and the reaction, because sometimes it happens so quickly. And that's why this year they put in on flagrant twos, they're always reviewed. Maybe they should put in a rule on all flagrant fouls to review it, not just flagrant twos.
To me, there should be flagrant two. There should be an ejection or nothing. If you think something's so bad, just kick the guy out of the game. If not, play on.
Ray Allen drives, puts it up, shot won't go, tried to tip it, gets it back. Ray Allen so aggressive, and he's got 17 points.
I think it's scary when you and I agree. I start to question myself sometimes when we agree too much.
It's allowed to happen.
Well, we can agree right now. The Celtics aren't getting back in transition. Right there, again, two straight plays. You're playing the score if you're the Celtics. You're not playing the game. Believe me, their effort would have been better in transition if they were tie game or behind. And this is what gets you in trouble, this thinking about play sometimes, don't play other times. Here, they score. You should never get beaten down the floor. The Pistons aren't even running hard after a made basket. They just throw it up to Prince. I mean, that's just bad. That's just bad effort by the Celtics.
Prince hits the free throw. 15-point Boston lead, 3.5 remaining, third quarter. Here of game five of the Eastern Conference Finals. Boston jumped out early. Pistons came back up by as many as 8. This third quarter has belonged to the Celtics, though, as they've led by as many as 17, trying to take a 3-2 lead in this best of 7 series. Rondo to the basket, can't get it to fall, and Prince the rebound. Phillips pulls up for 3, knocks it down. Chauncey Phillips with a clutch 3, and it's back to 12.
And really, that's the message that you send to Doc Rivers. Don't let them hang around. Making crucial mistakes when you can bury a team, you are giving them life.
And again, after all the struggles from three-point range in the first 4 games, both teams excellent from downtown. Ray Allen, the runner, banks it in. 19 for Allen. And he's got 11 of them here in the third quarter. Looking up at the shot clock. Down to 4. Prince is going to have to make a play. Up to Stuckey. Stuckey on the drive. Pulls up and puts it in as the shot clock expires. For a young kid, he's got so much poise.
What I love about him, he doesn't care. He's playing the same way that he played in the regular season. Has no clue that he's in the Eastern Conference Finals. His future is awfully bright.
One of his teammates even said that. Said he's out there in a big spot. It's like he's playing in the playground. He just looks like he's never nervous. And a foul call against Stuckey. Meanwhile, the Celtics in game 4, all they did, they shot 32% from the field. Really struggled. Tonight, 54%. And ball movement a part of it, as you see with the 20 assists. Because they're in the penalty, Allen back to the line. Well, the Celtics had 75 points total in game 4. They've already surpassed that, and we still have over a quarter to go. Ray Allen, who has a 25-point game in game 2, coming right back with a 21-point game here in game 5 after really struggling in Detroit. Have another whistle. Celtics with the foul. Posey, his second. And the Celtics in a penalty.
Well, we've talked about this. In this situation, if you're the Celtics or the Pistons, realize that both teams in the penalty, you don't want to give up free shots. You don't want to allow guys to get to the line.
So Hamilton will go to the line. Garnett getting his rest. First, this game 5. Game 5 of the Western Conference tomorrow night. Game 4 ending in controversial fashion last night in San Antonio. This, of course, the final play. Brent Barry was magnificent last night. The contact with Fisher, no call was made, and the Lakers took a 3-1 lead. Well, just a short time ago, the NBA league office with an announcement that they reviewed the final play of that game and acknowledged that a 2-shot foul should have been called on Derek Fisher because they were in the penalty and should have been before the shot. That's certainly not going to, as Ray Allen hits another 3. Ray Allen, red hot from downtown. And a lead back up to 15. Perkins with the steal. He got away with a foul there. Perkins hacked by Phillips. As he went down, now Hamilton and Posey join. And they're going to probably get hit with double technicals. As the Celtics starting to take command here in the third. Now, Paul, what is it? You're up by 15 points and you're still drawing away. The last thing you want to do is ignite a team. That's just ridiculous.
Well, it's not ridiculous because what he's doing is he's getting the back of his big man. Felt like it was a hard foul by Billups in transition by Perkins. He's just returning the favor because this is what Perkins would do if Posey was the guy with the ball in his hands. You got to control everything and let it be known. My big man will not be abused.
Perkins doing everything tonight and leading the break as well.
They might want to hit the delete button from that part of his game.
Lumbering down, but what a great performance for him. Meanwhile, just to quickly get back to the Lakers Spurs, what were your thoughts on the call last night or the no call and then on the announcement today?
I give the league credit for basically manning up and saying a mistake was made. I talked to at least 15 players before the game, and every player agreed that's not a call. If you talk to the coaches, they agree that it should be a call, but I totally agree. Just play it through. If you're Brent Barry, get the contact.
See, my whole thing is, if the league would just acknowledge that we're going to officiate the last minute or two differently, then to me, that's no call. But if we're going to say that we're going to call foul one, minute one through minute 48 the same way, which I don't think is the right thing. I don't think the same call should be made in minute 48 as minute one. You set the tone early in the game, but it has to be something significant to call a foul. So I think the referees were right not to call it last night, but I think they have to just say we're going to call it differently late in the game.
Stuckey pushes off on Ray Allen. Ray Allen making his presence felt in a number of ways.
When you talk about raising the stakes, you think Ray Allen has no business picking up Stuckey full court, but sending a message. The second contact is always called. Stuckey, the forearm to the neck of Ray Allen, giving his team the possession.
And just show you how the Pistons out of character. 7 turnovers here in this third quarter. They average just about 10 a game for the series. And an illegal screen set out of bounds by the Celtics, so that's a violation.
We're seeing all the calls tonight.
I'm going to give credit to Rondo for the first time all season long. For me, he's playing the point guard position. He is patient, waiting for sets to be ran, and trying to find Ray Allen in situations where there's multiple screens.
13 assists for Rondo.
No, I scratched the 2-for-11. I can care less about the shooting, but he is running this basketball team.
Hamilton is fouled. Perkins doesn't like the call, but he picks up his second. Celtics in the penalty.
And that's a foul. And as Kendrick Perkins, another step in his development, is realized when you have a complaint and when you don't, but you got to maintain your credibility, because if you complain on every call, then we're going to have to take away his nickname.
Come on, KP43, you're better than that.
KP43 having the game of his life. As Hamilton hits Thursday on TNT, Western Conference Finals, Game 5, San Antonio down 3-1 at the Lakers. Marv Albert and Doug Collins will have the call. Coverage beginning at 9 Eastern with our friends at TNT. Then Friday, ESPN, Game 6 of this series back at the Palace. Coverage begins at 7:30 with our pregame, and then tip off shortly after 8:30.
I got a problem with his friends at TNT. This is a playoff. There are no friends in the playoffs. We'll compete.
Rondo, what's wrong with you?
It's war between me and Doug Collins.
DJ Brown steps up, can't get it to go, and Billups the rebound. Final minute of what has been a strong third quarter for Boston. Rondo fights over a screen. Billups blocked by Rondo. We talked so much about the big three, but Rondo and Perkins, the other two starters, have been superb tonight for the Celtics.
And you look at the block by Rondo, but Perkins put him in position to come up with the block, helping off pick and rolls, helping in situations because he's guarding non-scorers in Maxiel and Rack.
10 on the shot clock. Hamilton. Boy, just so smooth. So Hamilton with 16 points.
And here's where Doc Rivers loves to put the ball in the hands of Rondo and spread the floor and trust that his young point guard will make a play.
Crowd getting on its feet. About a second difference between the shot clock and game clock. Rondo ball fake, stripped by Phillips. Nice play. And the Celtics will inbound with 5 on the 24. 6.4 left in the third. Eddie House is quickly going to check in. Lindsey Hunter will come in to defend him. Max Hill will sit. Actually, Hamilton's going to guard House. Hunter will get on Ray Allen. Chance of Eddie. Celtic bench have not scored a point. They haven't played a lot of minutes. But Boston's bench has not scored. They've only taken two shots. And now they put some, you see, 3.3, it now says on the game clock. I don't know why it just changed. So Mike Callahan over there to making sure that it's all set. So I'm just curious.
6-1.
There's the official strike. 62 years of experience. That's our unnecessary referee stat of the night.
Don't say our, say yours.
Yeah, you got to own that by yourself.
All right. I'm going to get that sponsored. Now they have 6.4. With 5 left on the shot clock, that's what it was. So everybody's fine with it. Rondo will inbound. Ray Allen puts up a 3. Won't go. Hamilton the rebound. Stuckey looks up, feels he has a chance, fires it at the basket.
Celtics lead by 13. Doc, in spite of the lead, or maybe because of it, a couple of sloppy plays in defensive transition. How do you clean that up?
Yeah, you know, the defensive transition was caused by bad shots on the other end. I thought we got a little shot happy, shot some quick threes when we really didn't need it. No floor balance. They get back and get quick shots. So we got to make sure we stay what we're doing offensively, and then the defensive transition will take care of itself.
I think this has happened in a previous game where you guys started to play the score instead of the game. How much of a concern is that?
It is, but we just got to play through it, and hopefully we learn the last time.
Thank you, Doc.
Thank you.
Mike?
Now, Michelle, that was game 3 in Detroit. They were up by 24 in the second half. Pistons made a rally, cut it to 9 several times in the fourth quarter before the Celtics head on. Now they've had a 17-point lead here in the third quarter that right now is 13 as we start the fourth. You see Perkins getting a much-deserved rest sitting there along the sidelines. Perkins and Ray Allen have been tremendous tonight. So it's Rondo, Ray Allen, Posey, Garnett, and P.J. Brown to start the fourth for the Celtics.
I like the move by Doc Rivers, keeping Rondo in at the point guard position to keep Lindsey Hunter at bay with that ball play.
Allen stripped, and a jump ball, they call it. Rondo, by the way, has played all but 2 minutes. Here you see the big scoring numbers for the Celtics. Look at the shooting in that third quarter.
And I think if you're Doc Rivers, you can find time for Sam Cassell and Eddie House when Chauncey Billups or someone other than Lindsey Hunter is in the ballgame. The pressure really bothers those guys.
Rondo and Allen trying to find a spot. Ball tipped. Allen able to catch it as long as it was tipped before. By another teammate, Garnett. 3 on the shot clock, has to put it up, drops it in. Garnett with a hand in his face and a lead back to 15.
You think about it, that's the third time all night long that KG has beat the clock with long-range jump shots.
25 for Garnett, 24 for Allen. Wallace has had his best game of the series and knocks down another 3, his 6th of the game. All of his points have come from downtown. Hunter bumping Allen as he comes up the floor. now you're going to see the trapping physical defense for the Pistons, trying to force turnovers. Allen on the drive, falls down, lost it, and he's called for travel. He felt he got tripped.
Good recognition, realizing that the clock is winding down, takes a peek, and then the step back jumper over Rasheed Wallace. And Paul Pierce says, that's getting it done by the big ticket.
Stuckey, Hamilton, and Hunter, three guards out there with McDice and Rasheed Wallace. Hamilton nails it, and just suddenly it's a 10-point game again. As much as the Celtics were terrific in that third quarter, Celtics look a little uneven right now. Posey can't hit the three. Hamilton the rebound. Ahead to Stuckey, deflected by Allen. And it's still going to be Piston ball. And Pierce will check back in for Boston. Allen's going to get a breather. And Allen gets a big ovation from the crowd. Hamilton making it look easy right now. He's got 20, and the lead, once 17, has been cut to 8.
And they are crushing them on baseline out-of-bounds plays. They're scoring every single time.
7 straight points to start this fourth quarter, and this building was rocking at the end of the third. It's gotten a little quiet. And Hamilton, hands all over. Posey for 3. Puts it in! And those are the first points from the Celtic bench. And they're now 8 for 13 from downtown.
And Stuckey makes the mistake. Flip Saunders is talking to him on the way down the floor. The help comes off of Rondo, not Posey. You must make Rondo be the scorer.
Offensive foul. They call it on McDice, his 5th.
And you see the double team by Lindsey Hunter looking to roam, comes over, gets the ball out of the hands of Paul Pierce. If you're Stuckey, your job is to stay at home with Posey, not to help off of Rondo. Make the ball find Rondo and make him beat us, says Flip Saunders.
Pierce with Hamilton all over him. Very aggressive defensively. Pierce knocked down, and they finally call a foul. Wallace, his 4th, so some foul difficulties for Detroit. 5 for McDice, 4 on Wallace. Nobody on the Celtics has more than 3. Actually, nobody has more than 2. Pierce, Garnett, wide open look.
What Paul Pierce is doing right now is releasing the pressure of the Pistons defense, making plays out the post, out of isolation situations, and finding guys.
Hamilton for 3. Chris Hamilton firing away. You mentioned it earlier, Jeff. In some ways, an underrated player. He's just lethal with that shot.
Yes, he's got such good technique.
Rondo. Ball tips out of bounds. Let's see the call. It's going to be Detroit basketball. Another hard-fought, tough defense, and emotion-filled game. These two teams, the best two teams in the East, the best two teams in the NBA record-wise in the regular season, battling again. But despite all the tough defense, both teams shooting extremely well. Guys making shots, both over 50% from the field. Wallace another 3. Short. And the rebound goes to Posey. Ahead to Rondo. Celtics getting big play from Rondo, Perkins, and Ray Allen, who has erupted with 5 three-pointers in this game. Bad pass. Posey throws it right to Hamilton. Here's McDice. Perkins with a hard foul. And McDice will shoot 2. As Perkins picks up his 3rd. Allen in this series, 21% from downtown, but 5 of 6 tonight. He has been terrific. And they needed him. So the dice to the line, and this is a free throw. First game 6 will be Friday night at the Palace at Auburn Hills. We'll have it for you on ESPN. Coverage starts 7:30 Eastern via NBA Shootaround. And then tip off from the Palace shortly after 8:30, where the Palace was on fire the other night. Place going crazy as the Pistons tied the series at 2 games apiece with a defensive clinic. Here tonight, though, the Celtics right now with the upper hand, but plenty of time to go. Pierce, Hamilton is right up on him. Pierce to Garnett. Pierce, wide open three. Perkins, the offensive rebound, and he's fouled by Lindsey Hunter. So Hunter picks up his second team foul on the Pistons.
And I think if you flip Saunders, you have to begin to think about getting Chauncey Billups back into the ballgame. The only reason to play Lindsey Hunter is because Doc Rivers goes with his backup point guards. When Doc decides to stay with Rondo, you might as well go back to your starting guy and Billups.
Pierce gets away from a double team. Another dangerous pass. Rondo wide open. Not even close. And it's the one thing he's struggled tonight. 2 of 13 from the field, but he has 13 assists and just one turnover.
And that's a good shot. That's an air ball, but that's a good shot. That's a shot you must take if you run.
Hunter misses. Pierce the board. Posey, wide open three. And the dice the rebound. Rebounding is 38-21 in favor of Boston. Big numbers as Stuckey tried to force it up. Here comes Rondo. But decides to take his time. Just over 5 minutes gone by here in the fourth quarter. Celtics with a 10-point lead. They've been up by as many as 17 here in the second half. Rondo passes up the shot. Garnett throws it right to Stuckey. Again, passing up wide open shots. Hamilton to the basket and puts it in. And Doc Rivers needs a timeout. Mark, if you're Boston, what do you need to do to hold on?
Well, trust your offense. Take care of the basketball. Be patient defensively. Make the Pistons work. But it's on the other end where they have to execute.
Jeff, how about Detroit?
Well, I think you have to decide if your flip sign is when you're coming back with your starters or if you're coming back with your starters. And then it's creating havoc for some turnovers and making those turnovers go into good offense.
Ray Allen fouled on the pass. That was definitely a pass. The officials discussing it. No, they're going to call overrule a travel. Kenny Maurer called the travel on the outside, and on the inside, Eddie Rush had called a foul.
And what forced that trouble was Lindsey Hunter rotating to Kevin Garnett, as you see Garnett on a pick and pop.
That's the wrong call by Kenny Maurer. The foul came before Ray Allen landed back on the floor. Should have been a foul commitment, and the Celtics had the basketball.
That was a bad call. Stuckey inside. Shot won't go. McDice tip doesn't go. Second one. Well, they're going to call a foul. Johnny Perkins. And it's on the rebound. So it's going to be a two-shot foul on his first miss. That's why, as we send it to Michelle.
Well, during the last timeout, you guys, Doc Rivers told his team, and I'm going to give you the G-rated version. Calm down, number one. Number two, take shots when they're open. And number three, play with composure. We're running around out there like we're nuts. We've got the lead. We've got the lead. Let's get into our stuff and let's execute.
A big lead, Michelle, that has been cut now to 6, 91-85. A big turnaround here in the fourth quarter. 7 straight points again for Detroit. What was a 15-point lead earlier in the period is now 91-85 as we're approaching the midway point. Pierce, boy, Hamilton playing very aggressively. Hunter almost stole it from behind but was out of bounds.
But again, they're totally disregarding Rondo, and they've got to get Rondo in Pierce's eyesight so he can catch the first pass.
And Pierce has to realize, I'm not going to get a clean look one-on-one. Help is going to come. I have to have the mindset of making the play, beating the help.
And what else would help him is if he faced up so he could see the double team coming.
Rondo looking. Garnett. Stripped by Hunter and stolen off the foot of Garnett. And the Pistons get it back. Here they come once again. The Pistons with their defense creating havoc.
And obviously Flip Saunders is saying the way we're going to win this game is defensively staying with Lindsey Hunter. And he has impacted this game, making crucial plays on the defensive end.
Hunter, the oldest Piston, the veteran An excellent defensive performance once again. Hamilton with Ray Allen on him. Hamilton kicks it out in the corner. Wallace puts it up short, and Garnett the rebound.
And their energy level is not good enough. They need to get the ball up the court so they have as much time as possible to run their offense.
Right now, they're playing a kind of not-to-lose style as the whistle's blown. It's going to go against. Oh, and a technical foul. First, the personal foul on Hunter. And then a technical foul. Rasheed Wallace with the technical. And what, for the Pistons, what an awful time. Now that's his sixth. One more and he'll be suspended for the following game as Allen hits the technical free throw. It was the third team foul, so now the Celtics will take it out of bounds. We've seen this before from Wallace. He obviously feels he wasn't deserving of the technical.
And this is a foul on Lindsey Hunter. A lot of contact. Paul Pierce trying to post up.
Now Wallace argued the call. That's where sometimes he gets in trouble. He'll argue calls that weren't against him. Kenny Maurer apparently had heard enough. You don't know whether or not he said one of the magic words. But every point right now is so important.
And this is the most difficult decision for a coach. Do you go with the team that's rolling with Lindsey Hunter on the floor, or do you take him out and get your starter back in there in Chauncey Billups? That's a difficult decision.
Garnett, a brick. And McDice the rebound. Well, you've got to credit. Richard Hamilton's defense on Paul Pierce has been terrific here in the fourth.
And he's overmatched. You talk about the size and strength of Pierce, but Rip Hamilton is battered.
He can't even get a shot off. McDice to Billups. McDice to Billups. Long three-pointer. It's good. Chauncey Billups from way downtown. And it's back to a four-point game. The 10th three-pointer of the game for the Pistons, a 10-1 run. And this crowd anxiously gets on its feet. Rondo tries it again. Rondo flips it up and in with the left hand.
That's a heck of a change of hands by Rondo to take the ball at the shot blocker and scoop it up under his arm.
Only his third field goal, but it puts the Celtics back up by six. Hamilton lost the ball. Rondo looks to push out to Allen. Allen back to Garnett. Up blocked by McDice for the foul. And Antonio McDice has just fouled out of the game. Rondo's been dishing, but struggling shooting, but what a move with his non-shooting hand here.
Well, when the team needed a move, he pulled the Beyonce move to the left, spectacular lay-in over Rasheed Wallace.
Our first Beyonce mention of the season. Antonio McDice, who has been so good in this series, has fouled out for the second time in the playoffs. So he's done. And not had a huge game tonight, but he has had a huge series. Detroit trying to come back from a 17-point second half deficit. 15 points here in the fourth quarter. They cut it to four. Right now at six. And remind you, visit NBA.com. Get into the 2008 playoffs at NBAstore.com. The best selection of team jerseys, hats, t-shirts, and more. Some anxious Celtic fans. They've seen the Pistons slowly chip away at what was a big lead. Detroit always fighting back. And there you see the fourth quarter. Pistons have outscored them by seven. Wallace with a technical foul. He was talking with Kenny Maurer a good part of that timeout. He did it the right way, though. It was a calm trying to explain his side of the story. Maurer was listening to him. Not going to rescind it, obviously. Now he's just looking at him, shaking his head. Free throw shooting has been big in this series. Celtics now at 79% for this game. Crowd respectfully quiet for Garnett at the line. Lead back to eight.
If you're the Celtics, what you're thinking right now, just two team fouls, you can be more aggressive closing out this game.
Hamilton drives on Ray Allen, tied up. Billups right back to Hamilton. Shot clock at 8. Allerton trying to create. Wild pass. Phillips, 3 on the shot clock to the basket. Puts it up. Banks it in. Beautiful move from Chauncey Phillips.
And the Pistons have downsized with Tayshaun Prince at the 4 spot.
Alley-oop to Garnett. And he's hammered by Prince.
Now here's my question to you. What's the difference between that play by Prince and P.J. Brown's play on Maxeal earlier?
Because he went up to try to block the shot.
You always say that it has nothing to do with that.
Or flagrant, no. Here, let's watch it.
This is a big time play by Tayshaun Prince. You don't want to give up the easy deuce to Kevin Garnett. Don't allow him to catch and finish. It's the right play by both guys, Brown and Prince.
You know what? We just won by TKO.
I still think it's a different play, especially because P.J. Brown comes from behind. I've been wrong many times. P.J. Brown called for a flagrant foul in the first half on this one. He's from behind them. He's
what
has
that
really
got to do with it?
There's a lot to do with it.
Where in the flagrant foul rule does being behind have anything to do with it?
I don't think those are the same.
They're the same in one way. None of them are flagrant. See, do what the NBA did. Just say we were wrong, we made a mistake, and then we'll stop badgering you about all this.
I'm wrong all the time. I'm not saying my opinion's right. Well, that's just my opinion. 3.5 to go. 98-90. Celtics clinging to this lead. Hamilton inadvertently poked in the eye, and they're going to get a timeout. One of the other players calling it as Hamilton obviously was poked by his fellow UConn man, Ray Allen.
And doesn't he have the mask on?
Yep, but it's there's an opening of the eyes.
Wow.
And you see that left hand come in and just, or is it the right one? He's glanced it. And he's trying to call timeout, one of his teammates as well. Now the Pistons have only one timeout left. Rip Hamilton was inadvertently poked in the eye. He couldn't continue, but was able to get a timeout. One of his teammates. Let's look at the replay. And notice the left side of your screen. Here's Tayshaun Prince coming in. Timeout, timeout, timeout. And they were able to get it before Perkins had the tie-up. No question he got poked. They just didn't see it. And Arnie Kander got attending to Hamilton. He's obviously shaken up by it. He has been terrific once again. Rip Hamilton has scored more playoff points than anyone in Pistons history. He's played in more playoff games with anyone in Pistons history, and that's why this team is so good. They've been together now 6 straight conference finals for the majority, for the core players. That's why you can never count them out, even when they're down by this much late in the game.
Well, they have good poise, they have good weapons, but I think they've really overachieved this year. I think, you know, for people thought Chicago was going to pass them, Cleveland was going to pass them, and to come back and have such a great year while developing your bench is a credit to Flip Saunders.
And I disagree with the overachievement. This is a quality basketball team that still has the core of guys that won an NBA championship. Using the young guys, they are still a dangerous out in the NBA.
They're an unselfish team. Don't care who gets the points. They just want to get the win. And right now, they're down 8. Shot clock down to 4. Wallace turns. Not that time. Rebound tipped. Prince keeps it alive, and they get a new 24. Phillips, good help from Perkins. Rodney Stuckey, the rookie on the drive, spinning. Phillips fires up a shot, and he's fouled on a 3-point attempt by Rondo. And 3 free throws for Chauncey Phillips. So Rondo picks up his 3rd. He has been terrific directing the offense.
Well, that's a smart play by Billups. Certainly contact by Rondo. You have to be a little smarter defensively. You want to stay aggressive, but you have to have high IQ to close out the ball game on the defensive end.
And your guards have to come with that initial long rebound. Second shots down the stretch, they just really hurt you.
Pistons have been the 2nd best free throw shooting team in the playoffs. Only Toronto had a higher shooting percentage. Phillips, meanwhile, is perfect. He's one of the best in the league. Struggled a bit in this series, but he is a clutch free throw shooter. and knocks down all three. 5-point game with under three to play. Pistons are in the penalty, so every foul will send Boston to the line. Rondo looking. Oh, dangerous pass to Garnett. Garnett against Prince. Kevin Garnett shoots. Shot no good. Perkins had it, lost it.
Well, I think rather than playing pick and roll and giving it to KG at the top of the key, put him on the block. He's being defended by Tayshaun Prince.
And Perkins has just been called for a technical foul.
Man, I hate this. I really don't. I mean, I don't know what he said. He probably shouldn't have said anything. But I just don't like these types of situations where technical fouls are called in the fourth quarter, particularly this late.
Well, but if a guy is mouth at all, you say you don't know what he said, but if he's saying the wrong thing.
Man, just move on. Sometimes you gotta have thick skin in this business.
How about just shut up and play?
See, yeah, but you've never played. You've never had like a call go against you like that in this type of game.
I agree with you, Mike. I'm on your side this time. Kendrick Perkins, KP 43. You gotta control your emotions and close out the ball game. Showed the body language and had to get teed up.
No way. No way.
Phillips bumped by Perkins. They don't call that one. Phillips ready to go. Perkins again with a help defense. Phillips looking. Shot clock at 7. Hamilton for 3. Won't go. Pierce the rebound with 2:15 remaining. And the Celtics clinging to a 4-point lead. Foul call. Again, Rondo with those high arcing lob passes, giving the defense an opportunity to pick it off. They got bailed out.
Almost like he's afraid. Take the trap, make the play. If I'm Doc Rivers, because of the last two possessions by Rondo, I'm taking the ball out of his hand.
Pierce will shoot 2. Pierce from the line tonight, 4 of 6.
That was a great closeout by Ray Allen to prevent Hamilton from getting a good look. And I just want to finish my point on Perkins technical. There is, and they always say, you get a chance, heat of the moment reaction, and then cool down. All he did was throw his fist, he cooled down, he moved on. It wasn't something that he kept perpetuating a disagreement.
But if you're gonna referee in this league, all that's asked of you is to be consistent. If you're gonna tee up Rasheed Wallace for trying to argue a call, well, you gotta do the same thing to Perkins.
Pierce goes 1 of 2. It's back to 5. Stuck. Forces up a shot. And he's fouled by Pierce. Doc Rivers upset with that call. And more free throws. Here we go again. Free throws are going to either win or lose this game for somebody.
We're talking about a rookie making a play against Paul Pierce, creating a contact and going to. That's a bad play. If you're the Celtics, trust your defense. Doc Rivers saying no way is that a foul, but Stuckey going to the line for 2.
And the rookie knocks down another free throw. Posey's going to come back in for defense. And it's going to be Perkins who will sit down. Again, with that small lineup that you talked about, Jeff, with Detroit, Doc Rivers trying to match up.
Doc Rivers going small, putting Posey in now so he can play the power forward position. But instead, I say punish Tayshaun Prince defending Kevin Garnett. Use the same lineup and post up the big ticket.
This is the closest the Pistons have been in the second half. They trail by as many as 17 in the third, by as many as 15 in the fourth. It's a 3-point game. Garnett kicks it out to Posey. Back up top, Pierce. Shot clock at 8. Good help defense from Rasheed Wallace. Pierce and Phillips knocks down Rondo and a foul. So Rondo will go to the line and shoot 2 with 1:36 remaining. Boy, these lob passes from the Celtics, so dangerous. Rondo a little shaken up.
This is as poor execution of pick and roll basketball that I've seen in my life to close out a basketball game from Rondo. Paul Pierce, your job is to take the trap, extend the defense, and then make the proper play with a crisp pass. Not the home run play, but a play towards the basket.
Rondo, you see in the playoffs, his free throw percentage is first of the night. He misses the free throw. It's still a 3-point game with 1:36 remaining. Both teams in the penalty right now. Celtics next foul will put them there. Pistons only have one timeout. Celtics have three. Rondo one for two. 4-point game with a minute and a half to go here in this pivotal game five. The winner will be one win away from getting to the NBA Finals. Phillips on the drive, kicks it out. Hunter for three. That's good. Lindsey Hunter from downtown. Excuse me, Stuckey, not Hunter. Stuckey knocks it down. And it's a 1-point game. So Stuckey, who came in the game and stayed there when Hunter sat, comes up with a huge play for the rookie. Eastern Conference Finals, all tied at two games apiece. This one's so huge. And with a minute 17 to go in the fourth, the Celtics clinging to a 1-point lead. Rodney Stuckey, the rookie from Eastern Washington, who's had tremendous growth all season, in the corner, nails a three. First, the fact that Flip Saunders has so much confidence to have him out here at this time, and he is also not afraid to put up a big shot.
Well, prior to that, made the play where he was fouled and went to the line. Then the young fella ready to lock and load in the corner, but help can't come from Stuckey in that situation. You got to realize that the big guy's responsibility is to help. The help can't come from the three-point shooter. Now it's about executing for the Celtics offensively.
Again, the Pistons in the penalty. Ray Allen, Rondo, Garnett, Pierce, and Posey out there for Boston.
And they're going to help off Rondo. Rondo has got to be ready to get himself in the right position and then be ready to catch and shoot or catch and make a play.
Hamilton on Rondo. Hamilton's defense has been terrific here in the fourth. Ray Allen with Stuckey on him. Wallace pokes it away. Allen gets it back. Allen looking for an opening. He's tied up in the corner. Throws it off Wallace's leg. And it's still Celtic ball with six on the shot clock. And Doc Rivers is going to call one of his timeouts to set up what is a huge play right here. And now the Celtics are down to one timeout remaining. You know, we said right from the start, these are two of the best defensive teams in the NBA. Certainly, statistically, they're the best in the East all season long. And the defense has been terrific here in the fourth quarter, especially with Detroit.
Well, right now, it's about the Detroit Pistons taking the Celtics out of what they want to do offensively, whether it's pick and roll, isolations, post-ups. They are active, long, and really disrupting what the Celtics are trying to do.
And it just shows you that last possession, how hard it is to play post-up basketball late. You've got to have a guy like Paul Pierce who can get the ball without a pick, without a post-up, and get his own shot. And usually, it's a pull-up jump shot.
You see the 16 points in the fourth quarter. That's after they threw up 32 in the third. Pistons just amped up their defense as they've done so many times. They've been just a great defensive team over the past 5 or 6 years, and they're doing it here at crunch time.
And I thought Boston had a chance in the third quarter to put it away with better play when they got the big lead.
Six on the shot clock. Celtics will inbound. Posey has it. Allen comes off the screen, fires a three, puts it in. That's a two. His foot was on the line, but he knocks down a big shot. 27 for Allen. 3-point game, under a minute to play. Phillips to the basket, misses. Wallace, the rebound, lost it, still alive, knocked out of bounds. And it's going to be Piston ball. It looked like Garnett touched it last. And they get a new 24.
And Mike, they have scored on every baseline out of bounds situation. To me right now, they have to switch some of these screens, and Posey's got to protect the basket.
Looking for Hamilton. And they have to call their last timeout. Excellent ball denial from Boston. And Flip Saunders is out of timeouts with 47.2 seconds remaining. And his team down by three. But a big shot from Allen, just beyond or just inside the three-point mark.
Well, your job as Kevin Garnett is to get airspace for Ray Allen. Just a little brush screen, gets Rip Hamilton off balance. Ray Allen catches, ready to knock down a jump shot, a big-time jump shot for the Celtics, giving them breathing.
Allen with his best scoring game of this postseason. Trying to get that foot behind, but you see that right foot right on the line. And correctly called a two. He's got 27 points. Allen from downtown with 5 3-pointers. This one's still far from over. Detroit ball down by 3.
Well, you see the adjustment on that last out of bounds set what Coach talked about. Rondo and Ray Allen switch. Rip Hamilton coming off the screen. You got to stay at home, and I think the crucial thing for the Celtics, don't overhelp. You don't want to give up wide open 3-pointers off of help defense.
And Mike, with the Pistons being out of timeout, not only do they have to get the ball in, obviously, but it could affect, obviously, strategy late game, not being able to advance the ball up the court.
Sometimes 47 seconds can seem an eternity. So many things can happen if you have your timeouts left. Remember, they had to burn a timeout earlier when Rip Hamilton got inadvertently poked in the eye, and then having to burn a timeout there when they couldn't get the ball inbounds. Celtics with just the one timeout remaining. Chauncey Billups takes so many of the big shots for these Pistons. Well, Rip Hamilton has been superb tonight. It's one of the reasons they're tough to defend, Detroit, is different guys can knock him down. Don't be surprised even if the rookie Stuckey takes the big shot. So it's Hamilton, Billups, Stuckey, Rasheed Wallace, and Prince. McDice is fouled out. Doc Rivers with some of his defenders, including Posey out there, and the other four starters. Pistons get a new 24. Prince to Billups. Billups nearly lost it. Now on the drive inside, comes up short, and Rondo the rebound. Pistons do not have to foul. And Rondo brings it across.
It was a great job by Rondo pulling his hands back and making Billups finish instead of bailing him out with a foul.
And I don't like the idea of a pick and roll. I'd rather have Paul Pierce make a play without being trapped.
Garnett has it. Shot clock at 3. Garnett looking. Shot clock at 2. Puts it up. Won't go. Prince the rebound. They cannot call timeout. Hamilton shaking up on the play. Here comes Stuckey. Hamilton still back. Stuckey looking, and he's fouled by Rondo with 8.2 remaining. So now 2 free throws. Hamilton did not even make it to half court. As you see him in a lot of pain holding that right arm. Now, was that too early for the Celtics to foul? Obviously, they didn't want to give up a 3-pointer that could have tied it, but there's still plenty of time left. And Hamilton is really hurt. Rondo committed the foul, his 4th. See, Hamilton and Ray Allen got caught up, and obviously it happened right there in that tangle with Ray Allen.
By fouling that early, Detroit can shoot both free throws. They don't have to make one and then miss one. They have plenty of time to make 2, try for the steal, and Lindsey Hunter inserted could easily steal the ball, foul, and then race the ball up the court and get the last shot.
And it's a rookie on the line. Clutch free throw from Rodney Stuckey, last year playing for Eastern Washington, this year in the conference finals of the NBA with critical free throws. Stuckey rattles in 2, and the Celtics will call their final timeout in a 1-point game with 8.2 remaining.
Mike, I always felt it was better to try to get the ball in from the baseline where you can run the baseline versus advance it by taking your final timeout. And we've seen in the past where anything goes on these out-of-bounds plays as far as grabbing and holding, trying to break free.
And they have a choice. The Celtics can inbound. They can advance the ball in the front court, or if they want, they can inbound in the back court. This is just game 5. Game 6 coming up Friday night at the Palace of Auburn Hills. We'll have it for you, starting pregame coverage at 7:30. Tip off shortly after 8:30.
And the reason why I agree with Coach is because you call a timeout and you allow Flip Saunders to talk to his team about strategy and game plan. I'm not upset so much about Rondo fouling quickly. The reason why is because I don't trust that he'll foul at the right time, so you might as well foul before they get a look.
And that's an important point. He was already on the dribble, Stuckey was, so he had to foul him further out where he couldn't raise into the three-point shot. The question is, do you want to do it at 8.2? And in this case, when both teams are shooting so well from the three, I thought it was the right play.
Eddie House now comes in instead of Rondo. Posey will inbound. Lindsey Hunter returns for Detroit, trying to deny the ball against Ray Allen, who's the Celtics' best free throw shooter. 8.2 remaining. Pistons will try and steal, if not foul right away.
You've got to get the ball in Ray Allen's hand.
Excellent screen set by Garnett. Allen dribbling, and there's the foul. A couple of seconds go off the clock. And Allen will go to the free throw line. I don't even understand why Ray Allen would put the ball on the floor, catch it, and take the foul. Really a risky play from Ray Allen. Good job of getting open, getting the ball into the hands of your best free throw shooter, and then Allen going to the line to put his team up three. He's one of the best free throw shooters in the history of the NBA. You look at his playoff numbers, spectacular at 93%. Hasn't missed tonight, but these right here are critical clutch free throws. Makes it a two-point game. Even if he hits this, 6.3, plenty of time for the Pistons to bring it up. They don't have timeouts, but do the Celtics foul and not make them or allow them to take a three?
Without question, that's exactly what Doc Rivers and Tom Thibodeau are calling for.
And they're saying, don't even wait. We want to commit the foul when they cross half court.
Clutch free throws from Ray Allen. Stuckey, they threw it away. Now Rondo fouls him, and that's the smart play with 4.5 remaining. Almost threw it away. And now the rookie goes back to the line where he just hit two.
Now what you have to do if you're Stuckey, in my opinion, is you have to make one and then miss one. Because if the Celtics get the ball in, you don't have enough time, and they make the two free throws, you don't have enough time to get the ball back up the court.
If you're the Celtics, do you put in a better rebounder along the lane? Can't do it now.
Well, I believe you, on the second shot of your Doc Rivers, you want to put a better rebounder on the lane.
Oh, and Stuckey misses. Now he absolutely has to miss. Celtics don't have timeouts. Now you're going to see Perkins come in to go along the lane.
But this is where the outside guys, Ray Allen and Eddie House, have to match up so the ball can't be tipped back out. Paul Pierce has got to stick with Stuckey.
And that's even in being in position to foul immediately if the Pistons happen to get the ball back.
4.5 seconds remaining. See Phillips talking to Stuckey. Mike Callahan, the ref, say, I'll watch him out here. They have to wait on the release to go in. Stuckey hits the free throw. I think he was trying to miss it. Pierce looking to inbound. Looking, finds Garnett. Garnett quickly fouled by Wallace with 3.4 remaining. Now Garnett can put the game away if he makes both. But so Flip Saunders will need a miracle for his team to pull this one out. You see the disappointment from the rookie.
But did you see how they defended Ray Allen on this inbound play? If you did that in New York City, you're going to jail for a couple of nights.
So Garnett, if he hits two, makes it a four-point game, game's over. But if he misses one or both, the Pistons can heave it down court and try a desperation last-second shot. They are out of timeouts. Garnett knocks down the first. That makes it a three-point game.
And they have to match up right here. Paul Pierce has got to match up. Rondo's got to match up. Posey and Allen, don't go for the rebound. Just get matched up.
And you got to be in position that if KG does miss the foul shot, you want to foul before they can get off a three-point.
Garnett knocks it down. Clutch free throw. Phillips comes the other way. They'll let him go. And the Celtics survive and take a 3-2 series lead. What a hard-fought game here in Boston tonight. Respect from Garnett and Rasheed Wallace. Rip Hamilton played a terrific game. Perkins was superb for the Celtics. As the Celtics See a 15-point lead whittled down to one here in the fourth quarter, but managed to hang on and survive. Ray Allen with his best game of the playoffs with 29. He's with Michelle.
Mike, thank you. Ray, what were the final 2 minutes of that game like for you guys on the floor?
It was electric. Just being in the situation here this postseason, as a Celtic member, we've learned a lot about ourselves. And I think, you know, we're facing a team that have been in these situations many nights. And, you know, I think we're growing every night we're faced with situations like this.
Learning a lot about yourself. I can't imagine how much you've learned enduring this slump that you've been in and seemingly busted out of tonight. What did it feel like tonight, and when did you know you might have your stroke back?
I never really looked at it like I was in a slump. It was just a matter of me just getting in rhythm, just getting into the offense and finding ways to get shots and helping this team out. It's been there, but, you know, you as a shooter, you just keep shooting and you never get down to yourself.
With about 6 seconds left on the clock, you were forced to go to the line. You and Kevin Garnett both making clutch free throws. Talk about what it's like to step up to the line in that kind of situation where every single point matters.
Well, I always talk to people about the pressure of shooting shots in this building like this with so many people watching. And we just had to calm our hearts down. I think, you know, you're so excited and your body's moving, everything's, your adrenaline's flowing. You had to calm yourself down and just take a breath. And if you notice, when Kevin took a shot, he sighed, had a sigh of relief where he just went and shot the ball and it went in for him.
Congratulations on the win, Ray.